Good morning. Good morning. Great to be here with you. Now, it's great when we have a chance for baptism, for Nicholas and Diane particularly. It's that important step in following Jesus. And baptism is not just a ticket for the future to be with God in heaven forever, although it's partly that. It's the beginning of a journey for your life following after him. It's the beginning of a walk as a disciple of Jesus Christ, ordering your life around his priorities for you. And one of those priorities that we are seeing more and more and more is how do we, as followers of Jesus, care for our world? And that's what, for you guys and for all of us, we'll be talking about today and in the coming weeks ahead. It's all over the news at the moment. Today is the start of COP26. Do you like the planning? This is where we're starting this series, and this is in the news at the moment. So as an introduction, just watch this for 30 seconds. Oh, is Dave going to be ready? So just watch this video for 30 seconds.
The 6 years since the Paris Climate Change Agreement have been the hottest ever recorded. The more we delay cutting greenhouse gas emissions, the higher the risk for people and nature. We know the 1.5 degree target won't be easy. It will require huge changes to energy and farming and the way we all live our lives. That's why we need a bold, clear, urgent commitment to 1.5 degrees.
We've heard a lot about climate change and all these different issues, and we will hear more, I've no doubt. And many people say climate change is the biggest threat facing the world today. But I beg to differ. It's not that I doubt the scientific consensus of melting ice caps and the changing weather systems and the warming oceans, all the terrible effects it has on wildlife and on the poor and on ultimately all of us. But rather, climate change is a symptom of a far bigger problem. Imagine tomorrow you switch on your television and there someone is declaring they've discovered a cure for climate change. There's a magical solution to absorb all of the excess greenhouse gases. Question: would we then have a perfect world with no environmental problems? Sadly, no. There are still huge problems. Forests are destroyed. Oceans are overfished. There's mountains of waste. The pesticides that we use are dangerously overused. And the rich overconsume at the expense of poorer countries. You see, climate change is a symptom of a much deeper sickness. At heart, human beings, in their relationship with the planet we live on, has got that relationship all wrong. We cannot simply go on living the way we are living. And it's deeper than politics or even technology. It's at the heart of who we are. So we need to rethink our planet and how we treat these things. So we're starting today a new series called Planet Wise, and it's based on a book, a really good book, called Planet Wise by a writer, David Buchlis, who is associated with Arocha, or Arocha, I can never pronounce that well, and it's a wonderful book. If you want to get hold of it, our bookstore, we're going to get some copies, or you can get it in your usual places, but it really is a good, accessible book to have a look at, and we'll be working through this over the next few weeks. Because what can happen with something that's all around us at the moment is we can get caught up in the latest hype of a good cause. So the question is, how does God see this world and our place in it? And what's the worldview of which we see the world around us? The worldview is simply the spectacles with how you see things. See, the worldview of people around us, if you're in the classroom or the university, or for instance on the television, if you watch Brian Cox and Universe, if you might have seen that on the BBC, the spectacles that most people are seeing the world in our culture in the Western world is through secular humanism. God is taken out of the equation. So as followers of Jesus, As we stop and we pause and reflect, how does our planet and creation fit into a biblical worldview? So let me begin with a little quiz or a few questions for you about your response to this whole environmental question. Where do you fit in and what is your response? Because there are a whole range of responses to the environmental issue and faith. So firstly, first response could be steer well clear. Steer well clear. You might say, all these kind of people who've got involved ecology and the environment, it's all a bit dodgy. There's new age and there's greens and there's tree huggers and all this kind of stuff. It's nature worship and much of it's influenced by Eastern religions and pagan ideas. I'm going to steer well clear. Somebody called Professor Gillian Prance was the director of the Royal Botanical Gardens in Kew, an eminent environmentalist and Christian. He said these words. He said, people who accuse Christian environmentalists of mixing with the New Age are reading a very small part of the Bible. It's in the scriptures in some way or another, from Genesis to Revelation, that you've got to care for creation. Second response might be, it's all about saving souls and not seals. It's all about saving souls and not saving seals. You see, caring for the earth, yes, it's not that important question for Christians, because the gospel is far more about saving souls. So questions you might ask if you respond in this way is, isn't it more spiritual that we look for the souls of people rather than the physical, material things around us? Shouldn't we just focus on evangelism rather than the planet? Don't we focus on heaven rather than on earth? Second option could be, it's about saving souls. Or thirdly, your response might be, yes, but not me. Leave it to somebody else. I'm glad someone is caring for the planet or being an activist on the streets, as long as it's not me. Surely this is just for those who have a passion for this kind of thing. I'll do my thing, you do yours. But as we reread the Bible, we come to realize, actually, that caring for God's creation is not something to steer clear of, that the gospel is bigger than just saving souls, and that everyone has a part to play. So the fourth option I want to encourage us is this: it's caring for creation is essential to following Jesus Christ. Caring for creation is essential to following Jesus Christ. See, as all Christians are called to pray or to read our Bibles or to talk about our faith with others, so all of us are called to care for our creation. It's an essential part of following Jesus. It's not just an optional extra. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to go and live in a treehouse or a teepee or campaign for whales or even go vegan. But following Jesus means looking at God's world with new eyes. Because I think we've failed to notice the plain message in the Bible about creation. So now we're forced to think again. And it's really good that this is on our world agenda, to face up to the damage our way of life is causing our planet. So today, what we're beginning with is all around creation, how it all began. Creation, how it all began. So let me pray. Then we're going to have our Bible reading, which Sue Gravina is going to come and read to us from Genesis 1, and then we'll launch into it. So Father, thank you that you are a God who we believe created all of us, all of this planet in its beauty, and we recognize that things aren't as they should be. As we reread this really well-known passage, I pray you speak to each one of us today. Whatever our responses are, wherever we are, encourage us, teach us, whatever age we are, help us to respond in a way that you're calling us to. Amen. So Sue, if you want to make your way up here, that would be great. Where's the microphone? Oh, it's over here. There we go.
Then God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let the birds fly above the earth in the open expanse of the heavens. So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves with which the waters swarmed, according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. So God made the beasts of the earth according to their kind, and the livestock according to their kind, and everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on the earth. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thanks be to God for his word.
Should leave that video going as we carry on talking. It's great to see God's creation, isn't it? Now, today I'm not going to enter the debate, you might be sad to hear, about whether Genesis 1 is accurate history or symbolic language. Because evolution and creationism can be quite divisive. In fact, what I would believe is the argument can be a distraction. Because the most important question is not so much how do we get there, I'll leave that to others to look at, but why are we here? Why did God create this world? And three aspects I want to look at today is about God and about creation and about humanity and our role within that. So the first thing is about God. We had in that reading in Genesis 1, God being beyond creation. God being beyond creation. Now, if you compare this biblical account we've just looked at with other ancient creation stories, there's one difference that stands out. It's that God creates out of nothing. God creates out of nothing. The phrase ex nihilo is the phrase that theologians talk about, out of nothing. You see, all other accounts of creation have some raw materials that they use and bring together that already exists, but not so in Genesis. God creates out of nothing. There was a story of some scientists a number of years ago who worked and worked and had been working together for centuries and got this test tube that they came and brought before the Archangel Gabriel standing in the hallways of heaven. And they said to the angel Gabriel, we've done it. We've made human beings from dust. Really, said Gabriel, from the dust of the earth? Yes, they said. That puts us equal with God. I see, said Gabriel quite coolly. Well, let me just check a moment, and vanishes behind these great golden doors. But a few moments later returns and shakes his head and gestures to the scientists to the door to leave. They say, well, what did he say? What did he say? He said, as he paused at the door, that you have to make your own dust. Before creation, the Genesis account says there was no light, no alien life, no soup. There was only God. It says God is a different order of reality from the created universe. Yes, God is personal, but God is also the greatest thing, that the power, more power than even the sun can touch. Creation emphasizes both God's uniqueness and his supreme power. God is beyond creation. But also we see God is revealed through creation. God is revealed through creation. A number of years ago, I was walking in the Peak District in Derbyshire. Beautiful part of the country, if you've ever been there walking. Stunning mountains and hills and scenery. And I was walking with a couple of friends. One was Mike and his son, James. Mike would describe himself as an atheist. James's son would be a keen Christian, follower of Jesus. And as we were walking, we were going up and up and up, and the scenery was getting more and more beautiful. And we came to this wonderful vista as we looked across the valley in Edale. And as we looked across that and we paused, James, the younger guy, he began to quote these words. He said, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. And Mike, the atheist, he paused and he says, when I look at this view, I can almost believe there's a God. See, God is the great artist. The world is his canvas. And God has quite deliberately left us clues to see something of who he is. See, in creation, it's the first chosen means of God to reveal himself. The Apostle Paul put it this way in Romans chapter 1. He said, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. God's power and character are revealed through nature. From the vast cosmos and the stars and the beauty of the night sky right down to the newborn baby. God's creation is revealed. Over the years, I've done quite a few Alpha courses, which, if you know an Alpha course, it's a chance for anyone to come and explore the Christian faith. And it's for people to come and look at the meaning of life and what life's about. And it's anyone of no faith or those exploring faith or just beginning a Christian faith. And on this one occasion, what I do with people, I tend to sit down with them and say, why are you here? What's brought you to this place? And I remember sitting with one guy, and as we went round, he said, you know, I've never been to church very much in my life at all. Never brought up in a Christian home. But the reason I'm here is that a few months ago, in our family, we had a new child. And as I held this new baby in my arms, I just looked at this miracle of birth, and I had to find out who or what brought this into being. I wanted to explore the Christian faith to see who this God is. So creation points us to the Creator. And the eminent scientist and inventor Isaac Newton said this. He said, in the absence of any other proof, the thumb alone would convince me of God's existence. So God is revealed through creation, and God is separate to creation. But what do we learn through this passage again in Genesis about creation? The first thing we see over and over again said is that creation is good. Creation is good. If you were to read through Genesis 1, you'd see that again and again. And in fact, seven times we read, God, it was very good, or it was good. Seven times we see God made the land and the seas, and then God stopped and looked and saw it was very good. Then the same again with the plants and the trees and the sun and the moon and the fish, the birds, the animals, and finally the people. It says it was very good. So God has created this world and reflects his goodness and his character. He made it and he loves it, and we should too. So firstly, creation is good, and secondly, creation belongs to God. The psalmist puts it this way: the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. It's a short verse, but it's actually dynamite. It says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. The world is God's, not ours. Now, we often talk of my house or our country or private property, but actually, it's all God's. And for a number of years, I think there's been some wrong thinking, even by Christians, where we say, no, the earth and its minerals and its plants and its animals are created by God and then given just for humans to enjoy. Now, in one sense, there is a tiny grain of truth in that. The psalmist, Psalm 115, says that the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to the human race. He has given the earth to the human race, so that is on one side. But also on the other side, the Bible says this: to the Lord your God belongs the earth and everything in it. So how can they both be true, that God's given us as human beings the earth, but also everything belongs to God? How do we hold those two in balance? Well, the answer actually is quite simple. Something can belong to one person in an absolute sense, yet belong to somebody else in a limited sense. Let me give you an illustration. James, for instance, invites his school friends back home. Come to my house, he says. And James is correct. It's where he lives. He's got his bedroom and it's his house. But the house, or his house and houses, don't normally belong to children. They belong to the parents, or probably more likely to the bank. But actually, James has use of the house, but he's not the owner. God is the landowner of planet Earth and all it contains, the oceans, the minerals, the wildlife. And yet, God has given us as human beings the role of stewards and caretakers of his earth. It belongs to God, but we are responsible to him for the way we use this earth and how we leave it. So applying this for us today, it has huge implications. We cannot just use up all the mineral resources without remembering we are answering to God. We need to take care with experimenting with genetic modifications to species, not just extract more and more minerals from the ground, or making large-scale changes to habitats, or destroying forests, or overfishing the stocks in the sea. Why? Because God cares for them and wants healthy stocks for others. So we need to treat creation with respect because it belongs to God. So we've looked at the fact that God is involved in creation, but creation is good and it belongs to God. But what then about us, humanity, you and I, in this picture? Well, in Genesis 1 and 2, it puts human beings into perspective. And it does so, I think, better than any other part of the Bible. There are two essential truths that we learn about humanity. Firstly, we are part of creation. But secondly, we are also set apart within that creation as human beings. What do I mean? Well, firstly, people are part of creation. In that book I talked about, Planetwise, by David Buchlis, in that, when he talks about that, he says of a story of his two daughters. And he asked these two young girls, he said to them, are you animals? His 11-year-old daughter, Hannah, said, "Yes, of course we're animals. We're mammals." His younger daughter, who was 6, Naomi, was quite disturbed by this. Said, "I'm not an animal, I'm a person." What do you think? Are you an animal? Well, from an early age, we are taught that we are different from the world around us. We see ourselves and our family, we're different to the world around us. But we say we belong to this human-centered world. But as you come to Genesis, it blows this view apart, because it says we are not so different from other creatures. In Genesis 2, it says we're formed from the dust of the ground. In Genesis 1, it says God made humans on the same day as other animals. We don't even get our own day in the creation story. We are so interconnected with the rest of creation. But this isn't the whole story, because people are called apart from creation. This is what Genesis 1:27 says. You've probably heard this before. "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So we are part of creation, but also human beings are made in the image of God. Humanity has a unique role within creation, unlike any other. So there's a tension we need to hold on to. Yes, we are earthbound creatures, but also we are image bearers. It's like two legs that we stand on. We've got to get the balance right. We are earthbound creatures, but we are made in God's image. And if we get that out of balance, we become unbalanced. So if, for instance, we forget on one side we're made in God's image, that we're just a creature among millions of other creatures. We're nothing more evolved than maybe an ape. We've got no other greater rights than any other species. If you think that, then logically there are two possibilities and two positions you might hold. One is an amoral position. What does that mean? It means nothing really has value unless it has a use to me. Only the strong survive by feeding off the weakest. And arguably, that is how the modern Western world has lived. We've treated Earth and creatures as something to be used by ourselves. But there's then the moral stance that you can take in response to this, which is this: all species, including humanity, has the same value. That has a big problem with how we live our ordinary lives, because it means we have no right to consume or use other species. We should all be vegans. You may have heard this argument. But in conclusion, we are both creatures of the earth and made in God's image. That's what enables us to be fully and truly human, to fulfill God's role for us, his description for us of how to live as human beings, such that we would relate well to the fellow creatures, the earth, and to God. But let me maybe bring this down to earth to finish, no pun intended. As we look at God's creation, the amazing thing it is, when you look at creation, maybe you feel so small and insignificant of the stars and all that there is that God has made. As we look at all the awesomeness of the galaxies and the stars and the creatures and the animals in this world, do you know we are known and prized by the Creator, who loves us and knows us intimately. Just as he knew every star that he created and called them into being, he could start in this building today, and those watching online, with you on the back row or in the middle row or sitting in your front room at home, God has called you by name. the great creator of the earth and the heavens, could move through this church and call every single person by name. He knows us, he's aware of us and loves us, and he's come to invite us into relationship with him that begins now and will never end. That's the wonderful news of a God who created us for relationship. Let's just pause for a moment to take in some of those words and thoughts, and for you just to reflect on the awesome God who created you, wants to have that relationship with you. Let's just pause and pray. Can I invite the band as well, just to make their way up as well? But let's, as you're seated, let's just pause for a moment.